Welcome once again to Christ Clarity Satsang. The demographics of this site are predominantly 45 to 65 in age. And there are some younger viewers as well. And some of them have shown themselves to be very intelligent. So the tenor of this satsang is geared toward very intelligent, mature people. And we talk about very serious issues and very serious preparation. I am very certain that the predictions of the Earth being hit by a solar flare, the massive dust cloud from the sun, protons, high energy particles, that is going to happen. Direct hit, massive direct hit on the Earth will happen for certain. I'm positive of that. I've always believed that this will happen. And now I'm much, I would say 100% sure of it. When? Don't know. I would say sooner rather than later. Probably in 2012, sometime in 2012 is very likely. We're at a solar maximum cycle at this time. I say these will be the times. The preparation for this is really the purpose of this channel. Spiritual preparation is the way to prepare. As indirect as that may seem, it's actually the best way to prepare for anything and everything that happens. Even if nothing happens, it still prepares us for all of the uncertainties of existence, all of the troubles. So it's not wasted time at all. But I say there is a lot of urgency right now, for sure, to reach the highest type of spiritual preparation. And so we are forging ahead with rather long satsangs that will give the viewer a chance to kind of soak it in. If they miss it the first time, they might catch it again later on in the video. We're so distracted these days that it's hard to listen. Very few people are listening clearly anymore. Have you noticed that? I'm sure you have, where you're saying things and people aren't hearing what you're saying. They're not listening. They're self-absorbed. So, it's important to repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat, so that at some moment it'll be heard. What needs to be heard will be heard. And once heard, it's much easier to hear it again. And it goes without saying that every single viewer of this video will have a different perspective, a different take on what's being presented. That's how it is here. Perception. No two perceptions are the same. Everyone sees the world differently, perceives it differently. That's the very nature of perception. Because of fragmented appearance of fragmentation. When one is spiritually prepared, there's a poise and a calm and a detachment, and one is able to roll with the punches, not too disturbed, not easily disturbed by anything really. So when we hear that there are going to be, major crises here on this planet, we say, well, not really interested in viewing that. And is there some way to sidestep it? That's the automatic question that arises for me when I hear, okay, there's going to be trouble. I say, well, I'm not really interested in that level of schadenfreude. And the misery of others is not really a compelling narrative. Because what it really is just intense reinforcement of forgetting what we are. That's all it is. And that's not really interesting anymore. So this world, facing the troubles that it is facing, I say, well, doesn't really interest me. The future of this planet doesn't interest me at all. Really does not. And so that begs the question, what else is there? And that's a question that has not yet been precisely answered, and may go unanswered for this satsang at least. But we can at least keep in the back of our mind, what else is there? If the future, I came across a topic on the internet, someone saying that everything was flat, everything was boring, the world is uninteresting, the future is not interesting, you know, very true. Really, the future of this planet is profoundly uninteresting to many. The game has burned itself out, really. Let's be honest about it. The play, humanity's play upon this planet has really burned itself out. It's old. It's a tired act. And we just don't need to keep recycling and recycling and recycling and say, you know, wow, look at humanity. How wonderful. You know, we know what it is. We know what the game is all about. Anything that involves bodies is completely geared towards forgetfulness of what we really are. Because what are bodies? Bodies are really vulnerability. It's the idea of vulnerability. And that's tiresome. It's boring. Doesn't matter what bodies are doing. The substratum is that there's vulnerability. That's always the message. And vulnerability is itself very boring, uninteresting, tiresome. So tiresome. And so many of us seek that which is invulnerable, which is truly stable. And in that seeking, we come to self-inquiry, which is satsang, and we feel that we're on the scent of it. We're getting close to it. We're looking for it. We're searching for that. And in times of crisis, or heading towards a crisis, we should be ultra interested and focused on finding the invulnerable. Because surely we don't want to go through the dance once again of vulnerability and all that entails. Such a tired movie, isn't it? I believe that we reach a point where it's almost like we just turn the channel off on this movie of vulnerability. And in doing so, we recognize that the one who is doing the viewing of this movie really isn't vulnerable. Now, this super solar flare, and our series of super solar flares, could take place at any time. It will be without warning. We won't really have a warning about it. Very short warning. very, very short warning. Minutes, maybe hours. Just the briefest of warnings. And I believe it could happen as early as July. It's possible. Or something else may happen then. Certainly July is a crucial month. Pivotal month in 2012. And there may be some that are ready to sidestep the turmoil here. The solar flares, the direct hit on this planet, will bring about turmoil. Massive chaos, I think, is a way to describe it. Because distribution and production and distribution will grind to a halt. Computer systems will be fried. Trucks won't be able to drive, cars, vehicles of all sorts, they're all run on chips, computer chips, they'll all be fried. No commerce, no raw materials, nothing is moving. And it's just absolute planetary chaos. The planet will heat up. There'll be volcanic activity. Ultimately, the atmosphere will turn be full of dust here on this planet. And as I've said in other videos, believe it or not, some view this with the greatest of anticipation, and they love it. They love the darkness, the misery, the dying, the suffering, this the entire gruesome misery of it all. They feed off of that. And there are others who are not really interested in that. And yet, if you're on this planet, you'll certainly be affected by it. It's not like you can be on this planet and not be affected by it unless you are in completely realized condition, perfectly realized condition, where nothing touches the experience that you're having. You're having an experience of perfect stability, and nothing can touch it. But most of us are not in that condition. So most of us would certainly benefit from being somewhere else. It's just as simple as that. This world really, in the future, will not be beneficial for us. Those who want to remember what they are, this world is not going to be useful in that way. Just a simple fact. Not useful? Let's find something that's useful. Just like that. This entire situation does not need to be dramatized. Neither does it need to be denied. I think that's the best of both worlds, is that you don't deny it, you don't dramatize it, you just state the simple facts. This is not going to be useful for me. I'd like something that is useful for me. Ultimately, we have to choose a new idea and experience the effect of that new idea of not trying to be prime creator, experiencing the effect of non-modification, non-negation, perfectly stable effect. We have to do that, but we benefit from circumstances that encourage us to do this. And the future of this planet it does not encourage us to do this. When one is in just strict survival mode, complete survival mode, everyone around is in the same way, it's not conducive at all. The situation that I'm in, for instance, right now is very conducive, very fortunate. And I have it because I'm willing to use it that way. So I managed to get in a situation where Not only am I able to do these videos and do the right study and the right focus, but it's continuous. It's been going on for a long time. So there are conditions that are conducive to moving towards remembrance of what we are, just as there are conditions that are conducive towards moving towards forgetting what we are. And there will be a parting of the ways, because the emphasis is so completely different, night and day, two different directions. Those traveling in opposite directions are not going to long have much to say to one another as they get farther and farther apart. They really are not going to be interested in, and cannot hear what the others are saying, are not experiencing the same thing. Those who want to keep on forgetting what they are so they can pretend to be prime creators, they have to walk in darkness. Have to. And for them, it's something they're willing to do. It's the price they're willing to pay. And you just have to bless them. You just have to accept that they're equal parts of the sonship. Sonship is all one. Reality is just one. They're equal parts of that. They're one too. They just want to try and be prime creator instead of the prime created, instead of spirit. So they walk in darkness and try and make it seem interesting. Don't have to feel sorry for them. They're not trapped. The perfect stillness that is present right now is always with them. Unconditional, no qualifications required. Everyone's pre-qualified for it always. So there's nothing to be sad about. Nothing to freak out about. Those who walk in darkness, they believe that they're on a really groovy trip. And they feel that somehow it's going to all work out for them. It's going to work. And they taste some bitter ashes along the way, for sure. And eventually they start reconsidering. But, you know, then they gradually slow down their pace of forgetfulness and begin to turn towards remembrance of what they are. But for now, those who want to walk in darkness are free to do so. Don't put any restrictions on them. The way to sidestep this whole thing is through forgiveness, through unconditional love, to using that, tapping into these attitudes. Give them freedom, those who want to walk in darkness. Give them complete freedom to do so with love, with complete support for what they truly are, which is equal to you, to anyone, to everyone, all equal aspects of the one reality. They're not doing anything wrong. They're chasing a silly notion, for sure. But that's not doing anything wrong. They're not harming reality. They're not changing any of reality's laws. They're not doing anything except wandering around and imagining that it's leading somewhere. So to those who walk in darkness, want to walk a little longer in darkness, they have our blessings. Full support and full blessings. just as those who want to walk the lighted way towards remembrance also have our full support and full blessings, including ourselves. It's possible to give full support and blessings to both directions. It's easy, because everyone has free will. Everyone can choose as what they want. No one will be lost. Reality is not harmed in any way. There's no harm. There's no guilt. Everyone's already pre-qualified to experience perfect remembrance of what they are. Unqualified, unconditional love. Everyone's pre-qualified. They can never be disqualified. There's nothing wrong. Nothing fundamentally wrong. Those pursuing tragedy are really pursuing the pretense of being prime creators. That's why they're putting up with all this stuff. It's terrible stuff. They put up with it. They're willing to put themselves through the ringer. Just for a taste of being prime creators. Just for that taste. And they sample many tastes, but none of them are quite what the taste that they want. So they continue on in that way. And eventually they have a taste of reality, and then they start asking questions. They say, where did this taste come from? This is the one I wanted. How come I can't have it again? How come existence is not giving it to me? All these questions arise. And eventually they sort through it. They simplify it. And they come to a point where they have conditions that help them. And they begin to see the simplicity, and they begin to realize that they simply chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. And therefore they had to forget what they really are, had to go into forgetfulness, had to believe that the ego was God. You see, when spirit tries to be prime creator, it has to completely forget what it is, because if it doesn't, then it knows that it's not prime creator, God is prime creator. It knows the prime creator directly. So, in order for spirit to do this, mind, the servant of spirit, has to present a very bewildering scenario of forgetfulness that induces this forgetfulness, and that's what mind has done. We call this presentation the ego. This bewildering, confusing, deceiving, lying, hypothetical scenario of plausibility is what we call the ego. The ego is the advisor. The ego tells us where to put our attention, what to listen to, what to filter out, what to emphasize, what to believe in, what direction to go in. All of this stuff, the ego is constantly advising us. In order to maintain our forgetfulness, and in doing so, continue to pretend that we're prime creators. The ego deceives us continually because we want to be deceived. And we eventually have to stop seeing the ego as the authority for what we want to experience. Now, as we try and forget what we are so we can experience being greater than God, greater than the prime creator, experience being the prime creator, we have to follow the ego's advice in order to maintain the forgetfulness of what we are. And so, in order to, because the ego's advice is so incredibly, totally vital and essential and important to us in order to pursue this objective of experiencing being prime creator, what we do is we believe that the ego is God. That's right, the ego is God. We believe the ego is God. And so when we listening to the ego's advice, we believe we're paying attention to God's advice. And in doing so, we follow that advice. We place great importance on it. This is how we deepen the deception. How we place ultimate authority and importance on what the ego is advising us by saying the ego is God. It's really God. There is no other God. We believe there is no other God except the ego. That's it. That's very useful for our forgetfulness. And of course, the ego is not God. Its advice is merely geared towards helping us forget what we really are. And that's not God's will at all. But by and large, almost all the invocations of God and turning to God and all this is really turning toward the ego. We're asking the ego to continue to give us the right advice and support us in the right way so that we maintain forgetfulness of what we are. But as we begin to remember what we are, we begin to realize that the ego is not God. We've been worshiping a false God. And this is, for some people, you know, that this is tough to just do it directly. It's a gradual thing. This is a gradual realization. So if you're getting upset about hearing this, don't worry about it, because it's a gradual thing. It only comes about gradually that one starts to wonder, and then eventually one will just say, oh, okay. In order to follow the ego's advice to the utmost, we insisted that the ego was God, the great advisor, who was going to lead us into happiness, the happiness of experiencing being prime creator. All a delusion, all an impossibility. So when we ask advice about how do we sidestep the problems that come, we can't ask the ego about that. We can't pray to the ego and expect a right response, because the ego doesn't want us to sidestep it. Which is why we seem to not get a response. I have to upgrade my own asking, because we are so habituated to asking the ego, listening to the ego's response. It's just a matter of habit. And so when we do that, of course the ego cannot properly respond to this question. Get the silent treatment, because the ego doesn't want us to sidestep it. The ego's purpose is that we continue to experience that which continues to bring about deep forgetfulness of what we are. And vulnerability, the display of vulnerability, is all important. Bodies are vulnerable. Things are vulnerable. The dance of vulnerability, that's existence. Existence is the dance of vulnerability, which greatly induces forgetfulness of what we are, because what we are is invulnerable, invulnerability. We don't even know what that is. We've forgotten, haven't we? Because everything we see here is vulnerable. Everything, every moment seems vulnerable to the next moment. So as we ask for guidance and clarity, it has to be from the true prime creator, or the it's the Holy Spirit. You can't spokesman, spokeswoman, spokesreason. Voice for the prime creator, that which informs us, Holy Spirit, grace of God, that we must ask that. What are our options? Because the ego doesn't have any for us. The ego doesn't have any options. Stay here. That's the ego's options. Hunker down. Go underground. Build a shelter. Store food. All those things. Those are, the ego is just saying, do all that stuff and that's it. But those types of preparations are not ultimately going to be satisfactory. They may buy some time, but they're not going to enable one to actually sidestep the situation on this planet. So in the days ahead, I plan on focusing in on this question. What do we do? How do we sidestep it? Let's get some specifics. Let's find out the answer to this. Because again, there's really no usefulness in not sidestepping it. I mean, isn't it when we look at the news and we see all the gruesome, terrible stuff that's just been on there nonstop? The massacres and the rampages and the bombs and all the horrible stuff are just constantly on the news, and we just look at it just and it just feels like so useless for us. It just doesn't have any pull. We just wonder, you know, what's the use of paying attention to this? Doesn't seem to serve any purpose that we're interested in. So we need to find something that feels useful to us and put our attention on that. And don't accept the ego saying, well, you just have to kind of hunker down, get through it. Because the world will be full of just very unfortunate situations. A lot of drama, too much drama. Unconditional love, there's no drama there at all, none, zero. It just is, steadily is what it is. Drama-free. No modification, no vulnerability, no sickness, no dying, in that effect, none. And we have already pre-qualified for perfect access to that right now. And so we need a place, we need a situation that reminds us of this fact. It's one thing to listen to this video now, but it'll be a whole other scenario when the solar flare, the effects of a solar flare, make a direct hit on the Earth. That'll be another thing. Who knows if the internet will even be up at that time. The internet may be down. Which is why it's important to listen to these videos now. I really expect that at some point the internet will not be functional. Now, traditionally, there's if you take the Christian tradition, there is a very clear teaching about the end times and fire, the world being burned by fire, which is basically the solar flare. Could be also a galactic superwave from the center of the galactic center. Combination. Anyway, it'll be burned. The planet will be burned by fire. It'll come like a thief in the night, no warning. And according to that Christian tradition, Jesus will return with all his angels and take those who choose to a place he has prepared. That's in John something. John 4, 1, you know, 1 through 14 or something like that. It's in there. And That's the tradition. And then later on, the tradition became clarified as a rapture, or as the people will be taken off this planet. And others have talked about planetary evacuation. Very similar themes. That before the chaos strikes this planet, there'll be an evacuation. And it may be in stages. It may be primary stage for those who are very certain, and then secondary stages where those who see the chaos mounting, they realize, okay, wow, time to head to for higher ground. And then they may go, and then there may be those who like to ride it out away time and realize that they're not going to make it. And they decide also to accept sanctuary. Some scenarios like that, I don't know for certain. But the more matter of fact we can make it, the more basic, the more simple, the better it is. It's just basically heading for a more useful situation, that's all. We don't have to get it any more complex than that. You see, those who are really focused, they don't get into arguments or discussions or anything. They just, if there's a situation that's not useful for them, they simply sidestep it, get out of the way of that, go to some other situation. They don't berate it or judge it or get in arguments and try to change it or anything. Just move on. Move on to something better. And that's what I advise. That's what we will do. No drama. There needn't be no drama. Now those that stay, lots of drama. They'll even see the leaving of those who sidestep it all. They'll see that as a huge drama. You can't stop them from reacting that way. It's you know, they'll say so many mysterious things happening. Unexplained, you know, it's all very dramatic, like tabloid mentality of the world is really what we have now. Those who want the drama are drawn to the tabloid mentality because that's what they're seeking. They're seeking the drama. They're seeking the forgetfulness. Why? Because ultimately they're seeking the experience of being prime creators, which is spiritual pride. So, of course, it is dramatic for them because they believe they will reach a dramatic conclusion of experiencing being prime creators. So, you cannot just make it seem blah to them. It's existence is full of hopeful dramas. And there's really no way that their minds can be changed abruptly on anything. Because there's a way to spin everything. Whatever happens, it's simply a spin of more drama. It's put into a dramatic context. And so it doesn't matter what the misery is or etc. A dramatic, poetic context is put on it. And all sorts of pop psychology is used to spin it like it's all good. And so it's not possible to reason with such a mindset. They'll just translate it into drama. There's no drama in reason. There's satisfaction. Like a quiet satisfaction, but it's not a drama. So those who are operating from that perspective, there's nothing one can say or do. Because they see their path as very dramatic. Whatever happens, you know, they can spin it that way. Full of potential, they believe. Dramatically full of dramatic potential. And so, of course, they're going to expect tremendous drama leading up to the ultimate drama they believe in, which is to experience being prime creators. So do not try and reason, persuade, dissuade those people who are addicted to the drama of it all. It's a waste of time. No matter how dark things get, they'll still see it in dramatic fashion. Which is a defense mechanism, of course. But they believe that reality has been destroyed, so they don't believe they don't have anywhere to go but down this dramatic path of trying to maintain forgetfulness of what they really are. They don't want to remember what they really are because they believe what they really are has been destroyed. So, of course, they don't want to remember. That's really the incredible situation, the nature of the situation is we believe that what we are has been destroyed and that we are like a fragment of that that escaped. And now it's up to us to create a new creation, that we're the new prime creators. It's as if what we were was blown to smithereens. And yet, somehow, we believe that we had some kind of warning and we were able to somehow escape that. So we feel that we're like survivors. The remnants, you know, the remnants of the destruction of reality. And we believe that the remnants have to work together to construct a new reality, a new identity, a new prime creator. We believe it's all up to us. And we need advice how to do it, and the ego gives us that advice, and we feel we're so fortunate to have that advice. But we are not the remnants. No, nothing happened to reality. Reality was not fragmented, was not exploded. Nothing has touched it at all. So we don't need to be afraid to remember what we are. But those who are afraid are very afraid. Let's keep that in mind. You can call it a dread. A terrible dread. And at that point, reason fails. One cannot approach the dread directly. It just has to be there. I've experienced that only through indirect clarification does the dread eventually settle down. And certainly in a time of crisis where one is deciding where to go, it's a very direct situation. It's very tough to speak indirectly, act indirectly. So the times that we're in right now and the times to come do not really lend themselves well to outreach among those who are still pursuing forgetfulness of what they are, believing that what they are has been destroyed, and that therefore forgetfulness is essential. So what we're doing here is we're extricating ourselves from guilt. Because we believe if we just stayed in harm's way, we'd be able to reach others. They don't see it that way. In fact, they would resent it. It's an amazing thing that even people who are experiencing trauma and receiving help, they're still not receptive. You would think that in extreme situations, they would become more receptive. They don't. That's what I have seen here in this world. They do not. They can be on death's door, and they're still just as uninterested as before. Because the ego, which they believe is God, is still giving them the advice to ignore this. It has no value to you. Don't be interested in it. And so they follow that advice. So a brief recap. We definitely will, this planet will definitely be struck by a massive solar flare, high energy particles from a solar flare. It definitely will. This will happen. There are those that will welcome this and the ensuing chaos that it brings. There are those that will see this as a great opportunity to be heroes and heroines and help everybody out and develop a spiritual resume through that way. Supporting, giving support, etc. And yet there will also be those who realize that the support that people want is not the support we think they want. It's kind of like they want to have the cake and eat it too. They want to experience the catastrophes, etc. And yet they themselves, they want to be insulated from it a little bit. It's kind of like watching the tsunami on television. You know, we want to watch the tsunami. We're kind of fascinated by it, but we certainly don't want to be there in the tsunami. And we certainly don't want to do all the work about cleaning up. You know, we've seen our tsunami on television, been there, done that, on to the next thing. Whereas those who are in the tsunami, they have to do cleanup from it. It's incredible, horrible. Let the dead bury the dead. Let the dead clean up the dead. Meaning, let those who are walking the path of forgetfulness and darkness, let them clean up their own mess. That might even bring about a certain sobriety when they have to do that. My life has really been a lot about cleaning up other people's messes. And that, what does that do? It doesn't help at all. Because then people will just say, well, I got the best of both. I get to watch all this catastrophe and engage in deep forgetfulness of what I am, go on an ego trip, experience the ego trip of believing I can really be prime creator. And at the same time, I'm not really suffering too bad from it because I've got others who are doing all the cleanup. So who does that help? It doesn't help anybody. Don't do the cleanup. Don't stick around to do the cleanup. Let those who want to experience catastrophe, let them deal with the cleanup. It could certainly sober them up. Just imagine if there was no one around to do the cleanup except they had to do it. They may start thinking, you know, twice about this whole scenario. Most certainly, there are those who are going to go through this situation, catastrophe here, based mostly on the fact that they believe that they are entitled to and will have plenty of workers to clean up the mess for them. Because the dirty work really is dirty, dirty work. The blue-collar, working-class effort that goes into everything they do really is effort. It really is work. Cleaning up people's messes is really work. And this world will be nothing but a jumbled, massive, massive mess. And there are those who feel entitled to expect others to clean up the mess for them. Which is why it's very important to get out of here before the mess occurs. Otherwise, there's a likelihood that we could get pulled into that class of those who clean up messes. I've already been pulled into that here. And been told that is the way to help others, be very useful and helpful. It's not helpful. Tough love has to be practiced. Because the more one cleans up the messes of others, the more that they're encouraged to continue on making messes, feeling there's no consequences to it. Somebody else will bear the brunt of the situation. That has to be dropped. And yet there is a class of entitlement, those who feel so strongly that they're entitled, that they simply, with this will and this focus of entitlement, push others into functioning as those who clean up the messes of others. Those who set everything back on the shelf, like an earthquake, very strong earthquake, all everything on the shelves fall off. And there's a group of people come in and they have to put everything back on the shelf. It's like that. Now what happens when we don't put everything back on the shelf for them? They begin to curse the ego. And of course, they think they're cursing God, but they're really cursing the ego. And if we believe the ego is God, we're going to feel as if we need to stop them from cursing the ego, you know. And so we think we better acquiesce to their demands. Otherwise, they may keep cursing and keep on cursing, which is, we feel, is not right. Because they expect, the ego has told them to expect that they will get help cleaning everything up, that they don't have to sidestep everything, because no matter how bad things get, the ego tells them that you'll have plenty of people to put things back on the shelf for you. Don't worry. And then, of course, in not getting this help, people will curse the ego and say they'll never listen to the ego again, except they believe the ego's God, so they believe that they're cursing God and they'll never listen to God again. And they blame us for their lack of faith, for their loss of faith. They say it's blackmail, spiritual blackmail right there. Basically, what they're saying is that either if we don't stay here to clean up the mess for them, that we are actually responsible for leading them away from God. That's blackmail. And they tell us if we really, really and truly wanted them to experience freedom from this misery and to know God, if we really believed that, we would stay here and help them out and clean everything up for them. That's what they say. It's not true. Because if we really care about them, what we need to do is to experience and abide in this feeling of perfect peace, perfect stillness, perfect reassurance that all is well in reality, and radiate this perfect assurance that everyone's pre-qualified. Radiate that out to the world, to everyone, equally. And that provides the true boost that is actually effective. Not cleaning up everyone's mess, that doesn't do it. They'll just make another mess, because that helps them forget what they are. So they want to forget what they are by making a mess, but they don't want to clean up the mess, because that doesn't reflects poorly on what they believe they are. I have become prime creator. The idea is that being prime creator, they don't have to clean up any mess. That's the notion. That's the entitlement mindset. It's an amazing mindset. Many of us have been through it. I've been through it. It seems impenetrable, you know, so confident of itself. You know, like as if a divine right of kings sort of thing. They have every right to demand that others clean up their messes for them. And this way they feel comfortable in going through all sorts of catastrophes and problems, but they're underestimating this one to come, underestimating it. Because the notion that somebody can set things right will be seen as ridiculous. So the notion of not sidestepping as if out of guilt will be seen as ridiculous, completely ridiculous. Because there's no way it can be set right. There's no army of people that can make it right. High tech won't work anymore. Everything runs on high tech. All transportation systems run on it. All scheduling runs on it. We cannot just throw a switch and go back into the 18th century or even the 19th century. It just doesn't work that way. I say that the world's been booby-trapped, and I make a very compelling case for that in previous videos. There's no question about it that the basing everything on microchips is a strategy of vulnerability designed to bring about massive chaos, which again reinforces our forgetfulness of what we are, which enables us to pretend that we're greater than God, that we're prime creators. Yeah, I'm doing the best I can here. I'm very sleepy. Woke up at 4 in the morning this morning and have been go ever since. Oftentimes one wakes up feeling hopeless. Doesn't seem we've made any progress. But here is something very important to consider. When we say progress, we mean securing our future here on this planet. And many of us have a feeling of we haven't succeeded at that. We have not secured our future here, which is very true. I certainly have not secured my future here on this planet, but have very well may have secured my future somewhere else, you see. So when we think that we're not being successful, we better review that, interpret it. If we look at our future in this planet and we say, my gosh, I don't have any future here. I've not secured it at all. Terrible. What's wrong with me? Well, we may very well have secured it somewhere else. And this effort, this satsang, all these things do just that. And in doing that, we're actually extremely successful. I always felt I should have been voted most likely to succeed in my high school yearbook. Instead, I was completely ignored. Didn't make any list of anyone. No one even signed my yearbook because I had a different idea of success. In their minds, I was the antithesis of success. I guess they may have voted me least likely to succeed, but they didn't have such a category. I probably would have won that hands down. And from their perspective, it would have been correct. Because as far as succeeding in this world, I'm a zero. Really, have not secured any future. But as far as succeeding and sidestepping the calamities to come, I may be 100, a total success. So you might want to reinterpret how you look at yourself, how you judge yourself. Maybe you're a tremendous success, even though nobody knows it here. Nobody knows it. Because most people here don't believe, you know, that there's going to be really a dramatic catastrophe. They feel that there may be bumps in the road, but not a kill shot, not something that really brings down planetary civilization into the dust. And so the notion of being successful somewhere else doesn't really arise for them. They're not prepared for it. But I was aware of this from the get-go, and In school, I was always aware of this, and I was always trying to bring the conversation back into these types of considerations, and people just thought that I was, just they didn't weren't interested. It was just kind of my conversation was just kind of, not interested. People were not rude or mean or anything like that, because I wasn't, trying to be aggressive or pushy or anything. It's just that they just tuned it out. It's just a natural tuning out, nothing to hear here. Let's move on. But for me, I felt definitely I should be most likely to succeed, because I saw success, meaning not success here, but success somewhere else. Actually sidestepping the problems here, actually going somewhere else. I saw that as success, and I believe I would succeed at that. So, amazing, differing views of what success is. For me, success is overcoming my valuing of this world, which I've managed to do mostly. That's success, not valuing this world. Seeing no value here in what we're perceiving. Not being attached to this world. Not having a tantalizing future here. Not having all sorts of, retirement money and plans and feeling that one has all sorts of things to do here. Not having any of that, that's success. Being aware of what is to come here, that's success. Being prepared, that's success. Freeing from guilt, that's success. Being able to bless everyone and not try and judge anyone for whatever which path they take, that's success. See, these are high successes. But I guarantee you, in high school, there wasn't anyone who saw it from this perspective, really. If there were others, well, I guess we were all kind of browbeaten into silence, so we're not aware of that. One time only, I had someone come up to me and just say, I see what you're doing, how you're helping others, and they said, nobody else sees it, but I can see it. I said, huh, that's very impressive. Actually, that person may have saved my life in a very, very amazing way. There was a bad influence on my life at that time. A quote unquote friend. I was trying to find some way to assimilate, and I felt this person could help me do that, but they really didn't really wanted to shake themselves free of me, and were really leading me down into bad situations, and I was so desperate to assimilate at that time that I really didn't. I kept going along with it. Well, this one person had a big disagreement with this. The one that saw what I was about had a disagreement with this one, my quote unquote friend, who was leading me in places I shouldn't go to. And it ended up that he punched him in the mouth and shattered his jaw. And this, my friend, literally had to drop out of school, and I didn't see him for the longest time. And really, from that point on, I never had contact with him again. Pretty amazing. Pretty amazing. The things that help us, we are hardly aware of, really, right? God's grace works in very mysterious ways. But guaranteed, if we are truly interested in remembering what we are, somehow we get into a situation where that becomes supported for us. We have the opportunity. Somehow, I had the opportunity to study the Course in Miracles for 15 straight years. A lot of that time, you know, all day, 16 hours a day, that kind of thing. For 15 straight years, I had that opportunity. It's pretty amazing. And now, with a busy life, I'm fortunate if I can grab little bits and pieces of time here and there. But now I'm able to spend time doing this video recording. Different emphasis. Sharing with others the kind of success that I've actually had, even though by the world's standards I've had zero. No one in the world looks at me as successful, no one. But those who see their destiny as being freed from this world, maybe they see me as likely to succeed, most likely to succeed. So today, confirmation came about the direct hit on this planet by the effect of a solar flare. The world is going to really be struck down by that, as foreseen by many. The next step is to get direct confirmation about sidestepping the chaos. It'll just be chaos on the planet, really. And again, to some, chaos is fascinating. To many, it's fascinating. There's a tremendous fascination with that. What's going to happen? What's going to come off all of this? It's like resetting everything, throwing everything up in the air, stirring the tea leaves. You know, there's some fascination to stirring the tea leaves for all of us. We can say, you know, the king is dead. Long live the king. Civilization has collapsed. What's going to rise out of that collapsed situation? We're always looking for the phoenix. There's enormous fascination with that. What arises after destruction? See, we're fascinated with that because we believe reality has been destroyed. And so the arising out of destruction to us symbolizes a new creation, a new prime creator. And so we're very interested to see what happens. What happens out of chaos? We throw everything into chaos and then we see how we respond to that, what happens. And all the social scientists will be, you know, enthralled by it. Like, this is like a, you know, this is a wonderful opportunity. They see it as a wonderful opportunity to study, you know, what happens when a whole civilization collapses. There are a lot of our space brothers who are here in this area now, who are here to watch this. They're fascinated by it. What's going to become of humanity? They're wondering, you know, they know the catastrophe is coming. Most of the space brothers know this, but they have different reactions to it. Many of them are not here to help. They're here just to observe, see what happens, see what humanity does. That's like a great experiment for them, really. In terms of social engineering and experimentation, this is a big one. 7 billion people on the planet suddenly plunged into Stone Age conditions. What will they do? For them, you know, for our space brothers, it is like the ultimate reality show. Honestly, they don't want to miss it. just as some are addicted to reality shows like Survivor or whatever. And I've never watched any of those Survivor shows. That just shows you where I'm at. I haven't seen a single one. Of course, I've heard them mentioned, but I've never watched one. I haven't watched any reality shows, really. I don't believe, not a one. But there are those, of course, who are fascinated by this. So our space brothers are here because it's like an episode on television. This is like the final episode, you know. And everything will be answered. So they're so intent on observing what happens here after this, you know, kill shot by the sun. The world plunged into Stone Age conditions. And what do we do? And they just, you know, they want to find out what we do. It's you know, the outcomes are many, you know. It's something like they just can't resist watching it. Too compelling. You can see that where they're coming from. But it's a bit shallow and cynical to look at it that way. Really. What comes of it is misery, confusion, and just an overall impression of vulnerability, which brings about severe forgetfulness of what we are, maintains it, deepens it, and that opens the door to an egoic mind trip of being prime creator. People will find themselves feeling heroic. That's the ego. That's the ego trip. Being heroic is the ego trip. So of course there will be moments of heroism, heroic action all over the place, massive amounts. That's the ego trip. People saving lives. And the space brothers are watching all this, and they say, look at that. That is so interesting. Look at that. They really are very much like we watch television. They watch planets, situations. They travel around to different situations and scenarios. Like sailors going from port to port. They catch wind of something. Hey, you know, there's this... going to be a solar flare kill shot event on planet Earth over there. And they say, oh, really? Yeah. Oh, that's really cool. Let's go check that out. It should be interesting. Once that one has mastered space travel, hyperspace and all of that, once one has mastered that, then, of course, the idea of traveling around becomes interesting and very possible to do. And so this event on this planet has attracted an enormous Nielsen rating, as it were, a cosmic Nielsen rating. High ratings. Maybe we'll have the highest rating ever for this show. And it's amazing, these space brothers, they want the show to go on. They don't want it stopped. They say, hey, we've traveled all this distance. We've paid our ticket here. We've paid to get here. You know, we've endured hardships to get here. And this is really important. They say, this has got to happen. There's no going back. We got to see this. We got to experience this. We need that kick. And so they don't want it to be aborted, that is for sure. And nor do they want anyone sidestepping it, because that they feel that doesn't give them a true read on the situation. It's as if one was watching Survivor, some reality show, and some people decide, you know what? I'm not interested in acting in this show anymore, so I'm just gonna get a plane and leave the island. That's take a plane and leave. I think the viewers would be very upset. They say, "Ah, that's not right. You gotta stick it out here, and you gotta to bring your attitude here on the island to see how others deal with it. You can't just leave. That's the attitude of most of the space brothers. They're all different attitudes, and some are here to help us leave the planet because they have wisdom and they know this is just all a dance of forgetfulness, dance of vulnerability. Serves no purpose for remembrance sake. So they're not interested in any outcome here." They're not interested in heroes. They're only interested in sidesteppers. That's a different kind of hero. That's one who realizes their true responsibility, which is to remember what one is. That's the only responsibility we have. So really, we're on cosmic television right now. We are literally actors on cosmic television. What everything that's going on this planet is being viewed by many. And really, we're being impulsed into various actions and activities just to satisfy the viewing audience. You know, this is live viewing, okay? A live viewing audience really can affect the actors. Really can. Just we know that the events are influenced by observation. Quantum physics knows that. On a different quantum scale, a large audience of viewers of live entertainment, it affects the actors, affects the script, affects everything. So those who really want the show to go on here, they're affecting us by their desires, by their intent. They're kind of like yelling out to us, "Hey, you know, entertain us. We want to stay here. We're getting bored. You've got to make us keep us interested in this situation." And that affects us. It really affects us. We're being affected in ways that we haven't considered yet. It's kind of like also live blogging where there's interaction. Live interaction, and we get feedback, instant feedback. We do something, and just all the observers say, "I wish you maybe would do something, do it a little differently than that." And then we, you know, make adjustments. And we're probably not even aware of this, but this world is being heavily, heavily influenced by those who are observing and want to experience what's going on here. Many from a distance, some firsthand. Just like we put in embedded reporters in war, we put reporters on the front lines of weather events, etc. Whereas most of the other people are back in the studio, safe in the studio, there's some intrepid ones who actually plunge into the danger and report live from that danger. Same way, there are some of these space brothers who have incarnated in this world who have done what's called walk-ins with people. Who have done various ways of actually being here on the ground so they can experience firsthand the drama. But most of them are at a distance here. What will become of planet Earth and humanity? How will they react? And we're told this is some great test for us, you know. There's no test. The real test is whether we sidestep or not. That is the test. But they don't see it that way. They see it as a grand opportunity to be of service to others, something like that. But what they really are saying is they want us to be service to them. Okay? They want us to stay here. They want us to provide them with a show and with data. You know, like a scientist wants data. That's what they want. No data, the scientist is upset, furious. If you sidestep the situation, there's no data for them to gather. They feel that what happens here has some extreme relevance for them. They can learn something from that. As if it's possible to learn something in forgetting what one is. As if that learning is meaningful. It's not. There are tactics that can be employed. So what they want to learn is they're hoping to gain insight into the tactics, what can be used, what they can use, what they can take away from the situation. And of course, if everyone sidestepped it, they wouldn't get any of that. So they're heavily invested in us remaining in harm's way. Heavily, heavily, heavily invested in it. It's all important for them. And yet, we don't have to follow their wishes. Because what they're doing also is helping them forget what they are, so they can pretend to be prime creators. They don't need any data to remember what they are, only to forget. And they don't need to forget, because what they are hasn't been destroyed, despite their wild protestations to the contrary, coming out of spiritual pride. So we're just loosening up the entire situation. Just loosening it up. Which is beneficial, very beneficial. That's really the best way to go about it. Continue to loosen up. It's like a ball of twine that's all, you know, tangled up, knotted up and tangled up, and we're just unraveling it bit by bit. Undo this knot, undo that knot, be patient about it. And see the totality of the situation that's going on here, that this event of the world is about ready to go under, is a cosmic event, event of cosmic interest, great cosmic interest. Many, many different types of space brothers are here. I call them space brothers because really, what are we? We're on this little marble, blue marble, out in the vastness of space. But we're, you know, in space. That's what we are. That's what they are too. We're all, you know, in that regard, we're all in the same boat. At least the manifestations of our physical bodies are in the same boat. So, you know, we're no different from them. They're no different from us, really. Inhabitants of space, at least we, you know, all believe that we are, even though we're not. So we just loosened up the entire situation. We talk about that we're on cosmic television, the space brothers are here. They expect us to entertain them and give them data. And, you know, if we sidestep the situation, they won't get that from us, so they discourage sidestepping. They can't stop it, but they strongly discourage it. Because for them it would be horrible if we all sidestep it. It would feel like, oh, terrible. shock, stunning for them. They want to persuade us to remain here, even to the point of being ignorant of this kill shot. I believe it is possible to pinpoint when it will happen. There's some that must know it. 2012 is very likely the year this happens. We're likely very close to it happening. It could happen any time during the time we have left in this year. And so they expect us to not even know about this. They expect us to be caught unawares. They expect us to not be able to sidestep it. And therefore, they expect us to participate in the great cosmic social experiment that's taking place here. And they tell us that they'll hand out all sorts of merit badges for it, you know, for our involvement, as if it's going to help them somehow. They're going to learn some valuable lesson from this all. They don't learn anything of importance. They can collect a lot of data and spend a lot of time crunching the data, but ultimately they'll come away with just nothing. Nothing's important that would happen. It simply maintained our forgetfulness of what we are. That's it. So, don't be intimidated by the Space Brothers and their agendas. Really look at it like someone watching a television show, watching a reality show, Survivor or something, and they're in their kitchen there, and they're all watching it very focused on it, very interesting, very into it, you know, and they may be ordering us around, being shh, quiet, you know. This is really important, and talking to us about it as if it were really happening and all that stuff. And don't be intimidated by that. They're just television viewers. These Space Brothers are, for the most part, just television viewers. That's all. They just hope for a show that'll keep them in deep forgetfulness of what they are. That's all that they're hoping for. But they have no authority over any of us. None. Zero. They're not superior to us. Anyone who wants to continue to forget what they are is not superior to those who want to remember what they are. Not at all. Don't have any authority over them. In reality, they're not any less just because they're chasing after a foolish idea, but there's certainly not money more either. At all. So there's no reason to feel intimidated that you need to do what they say. That somehow you're supposed to not know what's coming, and not know when it's coming, and not know how to sidestep it. Because really, other than this video and the others I've done, and some others on YouTube, and some postings on the internet, really, by and large, there's no conversation or talk about this whatsoever. So most people are unaware that it's going to happen. They're unaware of when it's going to happen, and they're unaware of what they can do to sidestep the problems that it brings about. Unaware of it altogether. So it's easy to conclude for us to conclude that maybe we shouldn't look at it either. Nonsense. It's simply that most people in this world share the same agenda as the Space Brothers. Most of the Space Brothers. As I said, there's some here to help us actually sidestep it. But they share the same agenda as forgetfulness of what they are. So they're willing to participate in. It's easy to convince them this is some grand cosmic social experiment, some spiritual experiment, with great importance, could yield, the ultimate data that we're looking for. We're looking for how to become prime creators. And we believe this event could actually yield that data. That's what they believe. They really believe it. They've got all these means to collect data, and they feel this Earth, this situation Earth goes through, is going to be the lodestone, provide the cornerstone to becoming prime creators. And they want everybody to participate. So they're just, you know, very glimp. They're nuts. They're mistaken. Logically consistent with a mistaken premise is insanity. The insane can oftentimes be very consistent. Just have a false premise, that's all. I'm bitten by the sleep bug right now, you know, have been. And you may have hopefully that this video is not too disjointed, but for some reason I've been dropping in and out of alertness. Managed to keep it going back on track, but it's been extremely difficult, I'll tell you that. The most difficult video I've ever produced here, by far. It may be that just bringing attention to this issue, there's so much pressure and stress not to do it, that my consciousness is dropping way down in vibration, and my alertness is dropping way down. Because there's an effort to dampen this information down. But again, we have every right to know what's coming, when it's coming, how to sidestep it. Those three things, we have every right to know those. Every right. We have free will, we can choose, because that'll help us towards remembrance of what we are. That knowledge will help us. And we have every right to remember what we are. And I believe I have every right to wrap this video up, because enough has been said, and I really do have to get some rest. So, we've touched on some delicate, sensitive topics here, really. And hopefully you feel a little more at ease about it. That's all it's about, feeling a little more at ease with it. And then that opens up the door to a little more conversation and focus. And so, to that extent, I believe it's been a very successful satsang. And with that, we will bring an end to this satsang. And we will meet again with another satsang at the appropriate time. Okay, very great. That's it.